So, my presentation, I think that it actually starts exactly where the previous discussion stopped, at least part of it. So, I will attempt to adjust it a little bit to be more relevant to what we have been discussing previously, at the danger of making it a little bit inconsistent. So, I'm an architect, so what I work with is the design process, how we design things, and more specifically how the networked nature of current societies affect the design process. So I'm working with networks, and networks have been described several times as assemblages, which makes sense. I mean, networks like the internet or social media are bringing together many different things. They have components that we can take out, replace them with other components, they can still work, etc., etc. But what they also have in place, all networks, modern networks, is a management style. That is, comes in the form of a protocol, where a protocol is actually providing the necessary framework for different things to communicate. It's like the common language that all components that become part of a network have to be able to read and understand. So my mobile is able to connect to the router in this place because it speaks the same language. And this language is provided by the protocol. What the protocol is also doing, however, is providing control over the network. And this is a tricky situation because it's hard to tell who is gaining control into that process. I think that the one who has control is the one who creates the protocol. Maybe in the case of the internet, which is the most obvious example, the TCP/IP protocol, maybe that is not very clear, but if we take the more modern versions like social media, Facebook, it becomes actually quite clear that control is in the hands of the people who create the protocols. We don't know how the protocols work, we just can assume things about the functions. So, assemblages. The reason I'm looking at assemblages, however, is not because networks can be understood as assemblages, but because I think assemblages can help us define the design process as such. So first, I want to point out some things as to how I understand the concept of assemblage, and that's where the connection to the previous discussion comes. So I'm going to... So I'm going to talk about three points that are actually expanding about on the ways we understand, we talked actually about the assemblages yesterday. Some of the things were repeated in the previous presentation, so that's a good thing. So the first one is that I think that we should think of assemblages as a concept, and it's quite impossible to think of it as a theory, because exactly, at least if we understand theory as a whole, as a set of rules and principles that have to work together and form a whole with relations of interiority, while assemblages have to be in a constant state of becoming, changing all the time. So I think for them it's impossible to become theory. You cannot use them as a way to analyze things or as a way to explain things in a totality. And in the same for the same reason, I think it's difficult to talk about an ontology of assemblages, because assemblages are not something, they are always becoming something. Unless, that is, we look at the word theory to the original meaning that the Greek word has, which is much closer to a point of view. So, if we talk about a point of view, then maybe in that sense assemblages can become theories. Only that each time they change, because the point of view is changing. And I think if we go back to the example that Manuel was describing yesterday about the Greek soldier and the phalanx and how they can be both assemblages, I think they cannot be at the same time because it's it depends on who is looking at the Greek soldier. So if you are, for example, a Persian soldier inside the battlefield and you're about to be killed by the fleet, then you don't really care about the phalanx. It's not an assemblage. You know that this is what brought the soldier there, this is what gave him the upper hand, but it's the oblique that you can see. On the other hand, if you are Xerxes and you are on top of the hill and you are watching the battlefield in terms of tactics, then the assemblage is the phalanx. That's what you care about. It's not the single soldier. And I think at least that's my take on this idea of assemblages of assemblages, is that in order to do that you need to see the whole. And I think that the whole idea of assemblages is exactly about not being able to see the whole, because you are inside this thing, you have a point of view, and you work according to that idea. So that was point one. Second point, which goes back to the previous presentation, is that the concept of the assemblage is positioned within the greater body of the work of Deleuze and Guattari, which actually I think it's quite consistent, and it's replacing the concept of the desiring machine, which I think it's important. It's important because we can find some of the ideas that they developed in the previous group, the Ambioedipus, and use them to better understand or define the concept of the assemblage. One of these ideas that is maybe clear when they talk about the desired machine is that an assemblage or a desired machine is something that is positioned within a field of flows. So it interrupts flows, changes them, allows them to continue, intensifies them, but it's always in this constant state of moving and becoming. Again, the reason why I say we cannot talk about a theory or about an ontology of the assemblage. Another important thing that we can take from this analogy is that assemblages, like desired machines, they don't mean anything. They don't signify something, they don't communicate, they don't reflect, they just produce. So they are like machines, they work, they produce, they break down. Okay, again some quotes from Jan Bielewicz. And then there's a third point. The third point is that the concept of the assemblage is an expression of Deleuze's, as he states, hate of dialects. And so his whole body of work is an attempt to establish a different way of thinking, not dialectical. And I think assemblages are maybe the peak of this attempt. He says that things can come together and do that in a way that is not dialectical. And for me that's important for the way I use the concept, because especially when it comes to fields like architecture where you have to create things, dialectics is the major way we think about it. At least that's what modernity gave us. So for architecture, for example, when we talk about architectural design, especially in Greece, because we have the Greek word, we talk about synthesis. We don't call it design, we call it synthesis. So we already pre-describe how this is going to happen. And it's only through dialectics. So understanding that the assemblage is placed within this larger anti-dialectics project of Deleuze, helps me a little bit to define it better. Okay, so back to architecture and how it deals with this network condition and how in the light of the assemblage. I think that architecture until now has two ways to deal with the protocols and networks and all this distributed condition. And the one is by following what we know to do, what modernity taught us. And this has two ways to illustrate itself. The first one, which I call a question of style, is based on the on the idea of the architect as an artist. So the architect is an artist, he has inspiration, imagination, whatever it is that he has, and he has the right to impose that ideas that he has or she has on what he creates. Mm? And in that case, the protocols, all these distributed ways of organizations are not really affecting the way he or she designs. He or she employs protocols, of course, computers and everything, but still keeps doing things the same way we used to do them. I think there is not much difference between this building, for example, and Ms. van der Rohe's house that we saw in the previous presentation. There are formal differences, but as a way of working, it's pretty much similar. Then the other way to think about this modern approach to design is actually the different side of the same coin. So it's not the architect artist, but it's the architect engineer or the architect scientist. Mm? He has rational reason, he can specify rules, therefore he creates his own protocols, and by specifying the rules through specific rational arguments, he can produce something that becomes legitimate because he is a scientist. So it's this dialectical opposition between the architect artist and the architect engineer is actually what constitutes architecture in modernity. And we can find it, both concepts, they become established by Alberti during the Renaissance, and we can find it throughout the development of architecture, modern architecture, of course. Le Corbusier is talking about both of them at the same time. So that's one way to deal with that new condition, and that's by keep doing things the way we know how to do. This is a way, however, that is limited to academia and high-profile architects. People, in other words, who can actually impose their vision. Then there's a second direction, which I call here a question of data, and it refers to this concept that we have been talking about recently quite a lot, which is the concept of big data, which refers to the ability that we have now to collect everything, actually, and store it. So we don't need to throw away data, we don't need to compress them. Everything can be stored, and important, everything can be accessed anytime through protocols always. So Mario Capo, for example, says that by having all these huge databases of everything, we don't really need to design anymore, because we can always go back to the databases and be sure that we can find a solution that fits exactly the problem we are dealing now. So he calls that design by precedence. And if we take this way of thinking further, we reach to a point where we say that we don't really need architects anymore, because it's the system, the protocol that access the databases and finds solutions to architectural problems and products. Okay, so what I try to do or try to say here is figure out how we can find a different way to approach this whole situation. And this is where the concept of the assemblage is coming. It's helpful, and also another concept from the work of Deleuze, the concept of the analog, which comes from the book he wrote in sometime in the 80s, I believe, about Francis Bacon. It's called The Logic of Sensation. So among other things, what he says there, he tries to describe how a painter is producing a painting. And he says that what the painter has to do is to understand what's going on around him, outside of him, which is chaos, everything, and he has to create a filter that chaos through that machine or filter that he creates, and transform it into the actual painting that he produces. So he calls that a filter diagram, but finds two different ways that modern painting is actually doing this. So the first way is we can find it in the work of abstract painting, like Modigliani, for example, where this filtering is happening through abstraction. So the painter abstracts the information he receives, but he abstracts it to a level where it becomes binary oppositions, right? Vertical and horizontal lines. So he is reducing what he receives from the field, the chaos, into code, right? It's 0 and 1. So Deleuze calls this process of producing paintings digital. So that's the digital way of working. And then we have the extreme opposite, which we can find in the work of abstract expressionism, about art informel, like the work of Pollock, where Deleuze says that the painter is not filtering anymore. He takes what he finds, the information, and he just rearranges it and puts everything on the painting. So on the one side, a digital process where everything is abstracted and reduced to binary opposition. And we have this process which Deleuze does not use a name. I will call it informational, maybe, where we don't have any abstraction at all. And everything is there on the painting. And then he goes on to find a third direction, which important, it's not something between the two, because we aren't talking about dialectics anymore, but it's a different way of understanding the act of painting. And he locates that in the work of Cézanne and Francis Bacon. So what he says is that Cézanne is not abstracting things anymore. It's not abstraction that is happening. And he is recording everything that he says, only that he is placing himself within the field that he codifies. So what we get here is a point of view. It's everything, but only everything that he can perceive from the point where he is inside the field that he codifies. And then he goes on, Deleuze, to say that this is an analog way of working, as opposed to a digital way of working. And he goes on to explain the differences between digital and analog by using the example of synthesizers. So he says digital synthesizers are synthesizing sound in a dialectical way. They have different sounds, they put them together in order to produce a new sound. Analog synthesizers, on the other hand, they don't synthesize actually. They modulate sound. So they have a sound and they alter it continuously in order for a different sound to emerge. So the main property of this analog way of working is the process of modulation, a continuous modulation, by altering something continuously in order to give something something new. I think it's a concept that it's quite close to this idea of the assemblage. So we have something. We have a field of things, someone inside the field, the point of view, and then we have this continuous modulation, in other words, a continuous state of becoming of things in order to produce something in the end. So that's the two different directions that we have, and what he proposes as an alternative. And actually, I think we can identify the two different approaches to the two approaches of architecture to contemporary design. Well, on the first hand, we have the modern example. It's abstraction, it's digital, and the computer is the ultimate machine, the ultimate production of the modern age. And works through abstraction. On the other hand, we have this obsession of storing it. It's the big data example, in a way. So I will show next an example of some student work trying to maybe illustrate a little bit better this idea of the analog. So this is work
produced in two courses. I was teaching the first is a little older. The second course we were teaching last semester at the postgraduate program we have at the School of Architecture at the Aristotle University. Stavros is the director of the program, so by the way, I will take some time to say that we have an open call, so if you know people interested, please send them towards us. So the exercise that the students had to do was actually very, very simple. They had to use a specific machine. It's a three-axis milling machine. It's a bit actually going back and forth, left and right, up and down, that takes material out of a volume of material. It's actually quite primitive for today's standards, so, because it's the three basic movements that the machine can do. And the typical process is that the designer designs something in the computer, sends that, the 3D model, to the software, which is the protocol, allows communication between software, design software, the machine, etc. And the protocol, the software, translates the 3D model into code that the machine can understand. So it's quite dialectical in nature, because the designer creates something, and most probably the machine will, the software will say, no, I cannot build that, and then the designer will go back, will change things, and that way, that's how things will happen. So the idea for this exercise was that the students actually bypass the software that they have to work with, and they build their own protocols, or in a way they try to communicate directly with the machine without having a model that they want to build. So in that process they had to start trying to find ways to say to the machine what to do. In other words, initially they started generating lines and telling to the head of the machine where it should be, and the results were close to failures in the beginning because they didn't really know what was that they were designing. But us, you don't really see much, but there is a drawing with sort of lines here. I think the contrast is really high. So by refining this process, understanding the properties of the material and the machine, things like this started to emerge. So this is a model that was not really designed in the computer. This is the result of the paths that the students created, the properties of the material, and the back and forth process between the drawing and the model. Want to go? Yeah, I'm pretty close to the end. Okay, there are many more lines in here, but that's one of those drawings was looking like. Just going to go fast through those drawings, those images, different results. So I think this is a way to understand the design process as an assembler, where the designer is part of it and works on the same level with all the other aspects of the process, the material properties, the properties of the machine, the intentions and desires that the architect has. All of them are operating in parallel, and they are constantly changing. Sorry. Something is wrong. Okay. More drawings and examples, just going through them. So all those are patterns and forms that emerge out of this process. This is an example that maybe illustrates that better. So those are the first models, lines on wood that don't really do much. Developed more, the drawings that you can see, and then this model was built. And this model was used to vacuum form plastic, place it on top and create a surface. But the result of this, this experiment was not really successful in terms of what the student was expecting, until we placed this piece of plastic under the sunlight and we realized that it was not creating the form that we intended to create, but it was creating those amazing shadows. So suddenly, the focus of the design process changed and became how we can control those suburbs, which was a property and an idea that totally came out from within the process itself. Okay, so I'm going to end here by showing you a clip. You have sound here. The computer has sound.
I guess so. Yes.
Okay. I think I have to turn it off. So I guess it's this idea of the assemblage as something that's maybe I should say always changing and subjective in the sense that it depends on the actual point of view of from which we are observing it. So this is actually okay. So this is a clip from Barbarella. Maybe not yet.
That's what happens when you say too many bad things about the digital.
I know.
Can you imagine the song?
The problem is that the same thing was happening when I was saying too many good things about the digital.
Say nothing about it.
You cannot really. Well, but this idea of the analog, anyway, it's not about not using digital tools. It's on the contrary. It's about the way of thinking and not the actual digital nature of. Sorry, this is not going to play, I think. One last attempt, and if not, that's okay. You were not meant to see it. It's actually here, so.
Yes.
So okay.
No, Barbarella. It was a nice clip.
This is it's a clip that shows the excessive machine, which is this bad guy that uses a machine that exterminates women through excessive pleasure, and then Barbarella comes to fight this guy and becomes part of the machine and finally destroys the machine by intercepting its flows of things. Relevant, but no. Okay, so that's it. Thank you.